Good morning, everybody. Very welcome to those from abroad to Barcelona. And I'm very happy to welcome also you to this discussion between four people. I'm afraid I have to tell you that we are missing somebody from India, which is not here. Srinivas didn't show up, but that's not a problem. It's even better because we will have a better discussion. The rules of this session will be as follows. We will have different presentations from the fourth participants. Not all of them, I mean, all of them belong to a city or all of them are from a place, but we will have three presentations on three different cities, and we will have a broad view from one of the participants. So my name is Montserrat Pareja, I forgot to tell you, but it's somewhere there. I am a professor at the University of Barcelona. I'm very happy to have been invited to chair this session. My research is on creativity and knowledge and networks and smart cities, of course. And this time we were asked to think or to, let's say, discuss about innovative urban development strategies. So I want to be brief, and maybe what I would like to say is that we would like to talk today about the conditions for the emergence of creativity, of innovation, and collaboration in cities. And I want the speakers, they already know that. I want the speakers to think in the, having in mind something like the context. It's not the same to talk about Tehran. We were talking right now that Tehran has 12 million people and Donosti has 180-something thousand people. So, of course, context is important. Path dependency is determinant in order to stimulate emergent sectors. And of course, and this is something that we will pay attention today, the different actors in the city and how do these actors work and play and collaborate, it's also a very important issue. We do have experiences from different countries. So in one of the cases, maybe bottom-up strategies, citizens' participation in order to get a more innovative and knowledge city are very important, but in some others, maybe top-down approaches to the innovative or collaborative city are even more relevant in order to get more social development. So we are going to see these different approaches. First, I would like to invite Gaetan Sue. He's the one who is nowadays a member of the Global Creative Leadership Institute. And he's the CEO of the Global Creative Leadership Initiative. And he's the one who will give us a very broad transversal perspective. So, please.
Thank you, Montserrat. Good morning to you all. Two elements for you to understand better where I come from. One is I'm a board member of Future Cities in London. And second, I've traveled maybe in about 200 or 300 cities all over the world. So this gives me some sort of local knowledge in a way. Innovation is not only about technology. Innovation is a lot about ingenuity and very often connected to survival. Especially in the emerging world, innovation is connected to survival. Even now with the global crisis, climate change and all this in the world, you can feel that innovation is part of a survival strategy. And cities are competing among themselves to attract investment, to attract talent all over the world. And cities where they come from before, they were crossroads. They were crossroads for marketplaces. They were seaports, were on the sea routes for trade. They were also, they are also airport hubs more and more for exchange of goods, exchange of trade, and exchange of people. And from the crossroads, they become development drivers because when you have trade happening in one place, you have more investment to improve the infrastructure, and this in return attract talent that brings more and more quality of life and infrastructure themselves and investment. And finally, cities, when you think of it, they are no longer problems by themselves. They are also solutions if they are considered to be integrated, and you can integrate different problems together to provide only maybe one or two solutions. Of course, leadership, vision, and all this are important in these communities. But I will give you three keywords during my presentation that will sort of, in all places of the world, most places of the world, most cities, they do use these elements as strategies in their development. One is the integration. Integrate, meaning that today with new technology, it is possible, instead of thinking in silos, that is transport, energy, waste, as single problems on their own, there could be common solutions and intelligent solutions. Estonia, for example, a small country, 1.3 million population, almost like a city, has long ago already integrated IT in all their activities for the government and the local government to deliver basic services to the population. Even in Africa, where infrastructure is very difficult, distances are great, roads are inexistent. Uganda, for example, are delivering e-healthcare by mobile phone at a distance to be able to bridge the gap and avoid developing heavy and physical infrastructure. In Valparaiso, Chile, they just developed with IBM a transport system which integrates different elements like traffic congestion and energy saving. The second point is optimize. Optimize why? Because the global demand, with the rise of the emerging class all around the world, the middle class, I mean, all around the world, will increase the demand for everything, for energy, for food, for water, and for everything. And we have to have a way to optimize what we have using minimum resources. And this is done by substitution with new materials or new technology to improve the way they deliver these services. Circularity, which means that they can find a reuse value, a different use of the same equipment and the same infrastructure, waste elimination, developing model that they can test and deploy. And we have two other, in addition to connectivity, we have another element, which is an asset which has been rarely used or seldom used in a way, because we don't think of it as an asset. It's time. You have 24 hours in a day, every day, every single day, and the same infrastructure, if it is used around the clock, can change the way we look at things. For example, a road is used very often only part of the day, especially in the peak hour. 8 on 24 is only 1/3 of its capacity. And this, therefore, the new technology allows us to manage the surplus and manage us to connect the demand and the supply, which we didn't have before. And then the last key word is innovate. Innovate, and by innovating, I mean the cities now add a theme to their development strategy to be able to be different. One of them is culture. Culture, we used to have art for the god, art and culture for the kings, art for art, and now we really have art for the market. And this is a new kind of soft power, 7% of GNP in many places in the world. I need not explain to you Bilbao here, the effect it had on the whole city. But this is not the only city doing that. Hong Kong, 40 hectares of reclaimed land on water, developing 17 different cultural projects, the first one being an opera, the second one is a 21st century museum. Sydney this very year has voted $315 million as investment in culture. Baku Cultural Center with Zahadid, famous architect. Abu Dhabi, La Sorbonne, Musée du Louvre. And Astana, new capital of Kazakhstan. Everywhere they are using culture as a driver for the economy. The second one, just an example, is knowledge. Knowledge being a hub. Knowledge, Melbourne is one of them, Malmo in clean tech technology, Eindhoven in high tech medical technology. All these are creating and investing in products, high value added products to be able to drive the city into new areas that will attract investment and will attract talent. And finally, I haven't spoken of Internet of Things. I will speak of Internet of small things that are really essentials to make a city different and to make a city livable and to that do not connect with intuition and so much data like we all understand when you are in a convention like here in smart cities. These are connected with elements that are not measurable, truth, beauty, and trust. And cities that engage socially their people and cities that are open and show great diversity to the world. Barcelona is one of them, Istanbul is another one. And finally, beauty. I think all these are elements that create the necessity, the essential elements of a great city. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. May I invite Mr. Ali Asghar Gaemi? He's director of the New Technologies Department from the city of Tehran.
Hello, everybody. I am from Tehran. I'm CIO of Tehran Municipality. And first of all, a briefing of Tehran. Tehran is the capital of Iran, a mega city in Middle East with population of more than 8 million at the night and about 12 million during the day. Tehran has 22 urban districts and 123 sub-districts. So this metropolitan forced us to think about a smart city to solve our problems. We have two major problems, transportation and air pollution. Our visions to solve these problems are city for citizens, clean and green, ubiquitous, sustainable, safe, knowledge-based, and cultural and creative city. And our strategies are intelligent management systems, encourage citizens to use e-services, economical and knowledge-based development, citizen participation, development towards e-government, and finally, objectives are national and regional improvement, improvement of life quality, development information system for good governance. Our major activities are three fields. A lot of activity in developing infrastructure, such as city networks, data centers, and other one. Another field is back office services, such as administrative applications, financial information system, and other one, or working on the GIS systems. And finally, if we can good act in infrastructure and back office fields, we can prepare good services in front office, such as e-participation, e-payment, e-education, mobile application, and official website, and other ones. this is a nice view of Tehran, and I'm talking about our infrastructure. Municipality communication networks in Tehran connects more than 1,400 buildings in all districts of Tehran, more than 1,000 kilometer fiber optics networks, more than 1,100 point of radio connections, and circulates 1.5 petabyte data. In Tehran, we have 7,650 buses, five-line metros, and until now, we issue about 10 million e-tickets for the people. So we saved approximately 40,000 trees and more than 330 million liters for our water in 5.5 years. Another our project in infrastructure category is making urban observatory. As you know, a lot of metropolitan have the same, and we created in the Tehran to gather all of data in city, demo and show to help the city council and manager in the city. Another of our activity is city front desk. We have 123 e-urban services center as a city front desk, which is managed by private sector and in the a single window manner or one click services. In the back office, a major project is working on the GIS field, such as the spatial data infrastructure portal, in order to introduce projects, share resource and information, define and aligning definitions, increase interoperability among spatial data providers. Our base map for other organization and business in Tehran include journey planning, street view, urban construction projects, Tehran point of interest routing, and other ones. Integrated and enterprise property system is a major project in Tehran that included financial and economic, GIS, e-archive, office automation, land applications, urban management system, and the other hand services, a lot of services for the people, business intelligence, reports, and so on. And finally, at the front office, we have an official website, Tehran.ir, that included 42 public e-services and 102 organizational sub-portals and 374 neighborhood sub-portals that managed by the people directly. As you know, the mobile penetration is very high today, and we need to develop a lot of services on this platform, such as map, history, weather, transport, city participation, citizen participation, urban requests, tax payment, and other ones. And we gather all of information about the city in the atlas.tehran.ir, and you can see that about land of Tehran, population and migration, education, activity and employment, and other titles you can see over there. Our way to the future: integrating databases and web-based application past. Mobile-based requests, web-based requests, online citizen participation past. And a smart and open data platform, services oriented and design and implementation. And now we are improving urban observatory, ubiquitous city, media center, and social connection with the citizen. And we are working to joining leader cities campus in using ICT, supporting science and technology centers and parks. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. May I now introduce our last speaker, Juan José Cue, from the municipality of Puebla. He's the Secretary of Digital Innovation and Communication.
Hello, everybody. Thank you, Montserrat. As she said, my name is Juan José Cue. I am Secretary of Innovation. Talking about innovation, we are the first municipality in Mexico that has formally a Ministry of Innovation in just realized, well, just founded 6 months ago. I want to introduce myself by first talking about Puebla. Everybody asks, where is Puebla? Or even they ask, what is Puebla? No, because everybody gets confused, inclusive for Puebla or Pueblo. No, and I will start with those two pictures. This is Capilla de Rosario, or Rosario Chapel. It was built in the 17th century and is covered with gold leaf. And at that time, it was considered the eighth wonder of the New World. This is Palafoxian Library, also built in the 1600s in Puebla. And it was the first public library in the Americas. So what was the issue with this city in colonial times that was so important, maybe perhaps the first or the second most important city in Latin America? Well, we like to say that it had a smart foundation. It was founded almost 500 years ago. It was called La Puebla de Los Angeles. Actually, we should have been Los Angeles instead of Los Angeles, California. But in the middle, something happened. And the project was a planned city. A need for a Spanish settlement between Mexico City and the most important port of the New Spain, which was Veracruz. And later that century, at the end of the 1500s, trade between Mexico or the New Spain colonial empire started to Asia. So Puebla was all, for almost 300 years, it was sort of the Panama Canal of the world. Trade between Europe and Asia went through Puebla. You can see there Los Angeles, and on the right Veracruz, and on the Pacific side, Acapulco. So this combination, this flow of goods and people, made Puebla a very prosper a city. No, we have, well, it was built in that area, the tallest bell towers, the cathedral with the tallest bell towers in Latin America. We had a very proud, we were a textile cluster. Actually, the first textile factory in Latin America was built in Puebla. We had the main theater, which is now still in function and is the oldest theater in America. But in the last 50 and 80 years, I wanted to concentrate on that part, Puebla started to lose competitiveness. And from being one of the most important cities in Latin America, we are now the fourth most important city in Mexico. And 5 years ago, after it was released a study from a federal agency, we realized that we had hit bottom. The city of Puebla has the largest number of people in poverty in Mexico. We are the fourth largest city in Mexico, and 5 years ago, 4 years ago, we found out that we have the most poor people in the city. So action was taking place. There was a change also in the state governor. A new governor, Rafael Moreno Valle, started functions, and the mayor of Puebla at that time started as the Secretary of Infrastructure. So what was done? Well, first, we went back to basics. No, we have a strategic location. If you have a 200-kilometer radius around Puebla, you will find that 40 million people live there. Almost 40% of GDP is done there. So we have to focus on this thing about Puebla. Also, we have human capital. Puebla has become the university capital of Mexico. We have more students than any other city in Mexico, well, just below Mexico City, but we cannot compare given the size of the city. But we have more students than any other city in per capita basis. Also, we have a safe place to live. We have been working on security. Puebla has not had security problems, but we are at the levels of not only from other cities in Mexico, but other cities from the United States and from Latin America. And we have been working in intelligence. For example, we have the largest police academy that we just opened 2 years ago. We have been working also in open government. Like Montserrat said, it's one of the issues of these discussions. And we have been growing places in the last 4 years, no? Being on the top five places, depending on which areas of transparency or open government have been. And we have focused also on investments. Puebla has become one of the most important automotive clusters. And just 2 years ago, it was announced that that Audi was going to build in the metropolitan area its first North American factory in Puebla. And last but not least, we have been working in tourism, and Puebla, the capital of the state, has grown almost 70% in the number of tourists coming to our city in the last 4 years. So talking about social innovation and social inequality, with these numbers of poverty in Puebla, we had to focus on smart city solutions. We started to work here with the people of Barcelona, with the people of IRA, with the people organizing this Congress and Expo, and we started to a plan this year. And I would like to focus on the solutions. No, we have other BRT, smart bikes, etc. But I want to focus on the most innovative solutions we have done. Poverty in Mexico and poverty in Puebla is an issue, and especially nutritional poverty. So we have a program to take these mobile food units to the special areas in Puebla. Instead of buying or leasing a fixed place, with this mobile, we will move them around the city. We will test them, and collaboration to operate these units is very interesting, because the people from the barrio, from the site, they operate the unit. And in order for a family to get the service there, one of the members of the family needs to take courses at the government, and they charge about less than $1 for the people. Another very innovative initiative and social initiative is Pink Rooms. And on the extreme poverty population of Puebla, families or multifamilies live in one room. They live and sleep there. So social risks are very high. So we are building these pink rooms, and we call them pink because the objective of these rooms is for female members of the family to live and sleep there. We have also another project, Bahías Digitales, that this is intelligent Wi-Fi units that not only give internet to social housing spaces, but also we have creative and programs for education. Talking about security also, we have smart police patrols. These Ford Interceptor are special police cars, and we are the first municipality in Mexico to have these kinds of tools. And last, talking about resilience and talking about sensors, we have deployed more than 100 sensors in hundreds of kilometers away from Mexico, so we can get information about earthquakes and move people where we have this alarm. So what comes next for the smart city in Puebla? Well, having the first public library of the Americas and being a university hub, we want to focus on bringing smart city knowledge and solutions to Latin America, especially in the coming year. That is why we are holding the first Smart City Congress in Mexico, focused on Latin America in 2016. And as our mayor of Puebla, Tony Galli, say, hosting this international event in our city should provide us with the tools to promote social equity in all Latin American studies. So we invite you to Puebla and I welcome you there. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. May I invite our last speaker, which is Juan Carlos Eizaguirre, the mayor of Donosti. I have to say that he was the only one fulfilling my requirements, that was no presentation. So we won't have a presentation. Yeah, you see, that happens. So I just want to thank him because he was the one following my indications. Anyway, whenever you want.
Bueno, buen día, gracias. Y efectivamente, mi formato va a ser diferente, no tengo presentación. Pensaba que iba a ser una mesa redonda, pero espero que la presentación no sea menos amena que las que me han precedido. Y a mí también me gustaría empezar por presentar nuestra ciudad, Donosti, que es una ciudad que está en el País Vasco, una de las 7 capitales, pequeñita en comparación con lo que hemos visto hasta ahora, 185.000 habitantes, pero no por eso no diversa ni no con sus encantos, como lo voy a presentar ahora. Es una ciudad que es conocida sobre todo por ser un atractivo turístico importante, por su gastronomía, por su cultura, por algunos eventos deportivos, pero también es una ciudad que cada vez se conoce más como una ciudad del conocimiento, una ciudad del talento, porque hay un tejido empresarial importante que se dedica a temas de innovación, de investigación, con universidades, con centros tecnológicos, y de alguna manera, por dar unos datos, hay más de 4.000 personas en una ciudad de 180.000 personas dedicadas a este sector, y más del 3% del Producto Interior Bruto se dedica a este sector, por encima de la media europea. Y esto lo digo para dar un ejemplo de que Donosti, aunque es pequeña, es una ciudad diversa. Y yo creo que esto es importante para que se entienda lo que voy a explicar ahora. Se nos preguntaba, en unas preguntas previas que nos mandaron, cuáles son los problemas con los que se encuentra Donosti estos últimos años. Y yo creo que hay unos problemas que son compartidos por ciudades de 180.000 habitantes o de 10 millones de habitantes. Y son las crisis que están viviendo las ciudades y la sociedad en general. Una crisis económica importante que obliga a, con menos dinero, atender las necesidades y los servicios que tiene que dar la administración, un ayuntamiento en este caso, y encima apostar, como es nuestro caso, por políticas sociales para aquellas personas que están más desfavorecidas debido a la crisis económica. Pero también una crisis de valores o una crisis de la política en general, un descrédito de la política, un desapego de la política por parte de la ciudadanía, que yo creo que también hay que gestionarlo y hay que darle la vuelta, sobre todo teniendo en cuenta que la gente participa cada vez menos en las decisiones políticas de los ayuntamientos y porque hay barrios y sectores que se consideran marginados o olvidados durante muchos y muchos años. ¿Y cómo darle la vuelta a esto? ¿Cómo hacer frente a esto? Y aquí poco a poco me iré introduciendo en el tema, pero me vais a dejar primero decir un par de cosas. Yo creo que cualquier ciudad, tenga 100.000 habitantes o 10 millones, está compuesta por una serie de plazas, de calles, de edificios, de infraestructuras, pero sobre todo está compuesta de personas. Y yo creo que no se puede olvidar a las personas a la hora de tomar cualquier decisión, a la hora de hacer política. Y nosotros teníamos claro, aquí se ha dicho que en la primera exposición que hay unas palabras clave y se ha hablado de optimización, de integración, de innovación, con las que estoy totalmente de acuerdo, pero nosotros tenemos una palabra clave, o dos, diría, que tiene que servir a la hora de tomar decisiones. Una es la participación, y quiero recordar que en la presentación Montse ha hablado de hacer las cosas de abajo arriba o de arriba abajo. Nosotros tenemos clarísimo que hay que hacerlas de abajo hacia arriba. Y luego está la priorización. En un momento en que los recursos son menos, hay que apostar dónde gastar los dineros que se tienen. Y nosotros lo hemos tenido claro, que en un momento de crisis económica hay que apostar por activar la economía y hay que apostar por políticas sociales, pero también hay que apostar por, a la hora de activar la economía, algunos sectores en concreto. Y antes de entrar en el sector de la innovación, voy a mencionar el sector de la cultura, porque yo creo que apostar en una época de crisis por la cultura es no solamente importante, sino inteligente. Y yo creo que la cultura no entendida solamente como algo de consumo, un producto de consumo, sino como algo que puede darnos cohesión social y puede valernos como herramienta para construir la convivencia en cualquier ciudad. Y hay otra apuesta que nosotros hemos hecho, que es en el sector de la innovación, y esto es debido, entre otras cosas, a que Donosti pues tiene un caldo de cultivo muy adecuado para apostar por la innovación, y yo creo que en una época de crisis ha sido uno de los grandes aciertos de nuestra ciudad. El caldo de cultivo está ahí, como he dicho, parques tecnológicos, universidad, empresas pequeñas y medianas que trabajan en diferentes ámbitos de las nuevas tecnologías, de la innovación, del conocimiento, y encima mucha gente emprendedora, que en un momento de crisis no ha claudicado, sino que ha decidido dar un paso adelante y muchas veces relacionado, debido posiblemente al contexto internacional, a este sector de la innovación. Nosotros hemos pensado desde el principio que esto a la hora de hacerlo impulsarlo desde el ayuntamiento, era necesario hacerlo teniendo en cuenta los valores que he puesto antes encima de la mesa de la participación. Y para ello hicimos un diagnóstico de la ciudad en el que teníamos en cuenta la realidad de todos los sectores y la realidad de todos los barrios que existían en la ciudad, siempre trabajando con la ciudadanía y con estas empresas. Y vimos que efectivamente en el sector de la innovación teníamos un recorrido importante para hacer y hicimos una apuesta para trabajar con estas pequeñas, medianas empresas y esta gente que empezaba, mediante esas apuestas emprendedoras, a introducirse en este sector. Desde el ayuntamiento, ¿qué podíamos hacer? Yo creo que la colaboración público-privada es importante en estos momentos y lo que hicimos fue facilitar la labor de crear empatías, de crear sinergias entre todas estas empresas, que no fueran empresas que con un tamaño pequeño compitieran unas con otras, sino que se complementaran y mediante clústeres en diferentes sectores hemos conseguido que estas empresas saquen adelante una serie de productos que individualmente podía ser muy, muy difícil. Como ejemplo, hemos hecho clústeres en el sector audiovisual digital, hemos hecho clústeres en el tema de la eficiencia energética y energías renovables, lo hemos hecho en tecnologías asistivas muy relacionadas con las políticas sociales, lo hemos hecho en el sector agroalimentario muy relacionado con el sector primario y con el consumo y lo hemos hecho con un tema muy en concreto que tiene importancia cada vez más en Donosti, como es el tema del surf, un deporte que está en boga y que encima genera un tejido empresarial importante a su alrededor. Y todo esto lo hemos hecho compartiendo liderazgo. Se preguntaba, en una de las preguntas que nos hacíais, ¿quién tiene que llevar el liderazgo en estos temas? Y nosotros siempre lo hemos dicho, el liderazgo lo tiene que llevar la ciudadanía, el liderazgo lo tienen que llevar las empresas que están trabajando en estos sectores. Es verdad que con una asesoría municipal, por lo cual hablamos de un liderazgo compartido, un coliderazgo, y teniendo en cuenta una realidad en Donosti, en el País Vasco en general, y yo creo que en muchas ciudades, que es el dinamismo. Hay mucho movimiento, hay mucho dinamismo, hay muchas nuevas iniciativas, y yo creo que ese liderazgo tiene que ser cambiante sin ningún problema y siempre compartido. Cuando se hablaba de y lo de arriba, abajo, abajo, arriba, yo tenía preparada una respuesta que era y muy en torno a este congreso, el Smart City. Cuando hablamos de Smart City, a veces yo personalmente tengo la tendencia de ir hacia el sector de innovación, al sector del conocimiento, de las nuevas energías. Y yo creo que el Smart City, el concepto de Smart City va mucho más allá y supongo que lo compartimos todos los que estamos aquí. El Smart City es urbanismo, el Smart City es movilidad, el Smart City es cultura. Y yo creo que en todos ellos es muy, muy importante, como he dicho al principio, que lo hagamos no de arriba abajo, sino de abajo arriba. Y para ello, en la ciudad de Donosti, tenemos clarísimo que tenemos que trabajar con la ciudadanía, no limitándonos a que cada 4 años voten para saber qué gobierno les va a gobernar y va a tomar unas decisiones, sino para en el día a día trabajar con todo el tejido asociativo, con todo el tejido empresarial que existe en la ciudad. Y yo creo que tiene que ser un trabajo dialógico continuo en el que ellos se den cuenta de que efectivamente ese diálogo trae unos frutos en positivo para ellos y para la ciudad. Y yo creo que es una cosa que estamos trabajando desde el primer día, desde que estamos en el gobierno, y que está dando sus frutos en positivo, incluso exportando ideas que se trabajan a nivel de clústeres a otras partes del mundo. Y yo creo, sin ningún problema, lo puedo decir aquí, y es una normativa nueva que ha aprobado este ayuntamiento, que en esa participación de la ciudadanía no nos podemos olvidar de otro tema que vale para Smart City como vale para cualquier tema que se trabaja en una ciudad, como es la consulta directa a la ciudadanía. Acabamos de aprobar una normativa en la que el Gobierno puede consultar a la ciudadanía los temas que considere de envergadura, pero también la ciudadanía, mediante una recogida de firmas del 4% de los habitantes, puede plantear cualquier pregunta que este Gobierno se compromete a que sea vinculante. Un poquitín, con esto quiero responder a esa pregunta que se nos hacía de cómo creemos que hay que dar solución a los problemas, si de arriba abajo o de abajo arriba. Yo creo que siempre contando con la ciudadanía y con los tejidos empresariales, asociativos que existen en la ciudad. Para terminar, decir que todo esto luego se traduce en una serie de ejemplos, que creo que tendremos opción luego de presentarlos, pero bueno, una ciudad como Donosti, de 180.000 habitantes, es pequeña, pero ser pequeño tiene sus ventajas. Y yo creo que una ciudad de 180.000 habitantes permite crear experiencias piloto, que lleva una ciudad de 5 o 10 millones, es más complicado, pero que sin embargo, por la dimensión, es más asequible, más real hacerla en una ciudad pequeña. Nosotros tenemos programas piloto ya en marcha, como puede ser Smart Calea, la calle inteligente, en el que hemos implicado a todos los vecinos de la calle mayor de San Sebastián, de Donosti, a todos los comercios, a empresas locales, de alguna manera con un objetivo de ahorro energético y de utilización de energías renovables, y los resultados ya los estamos consiguiendo con una satisfacción importante por nuestra parte. Estamos ahora mismo con un proyecto de un barrio nuevo que se va a construir en la ciudad de 1.400 casas, viviendas nuevas, en la cual es una zona inundable que ha sufrido muchas inundaciones en los últimos años. Lo hemos hecho desde el principio contando con los vecinos en las reuniones que se realizan de qué tipo de barrio quieren, y también es con los vecinos con los que vamos a decidir qué tipo de aporte energético quieren para esas casas nuevas. Y ahí se está haciendo una apuesta también por energías renovables y por que ellos vean desde el principio las ventajas que tiene una utilización de este tipo. Para terminar, otro ejemplo, y tendríamos muchos, pero bueno, estamos en un proyecto a nivel europeo, junto con Fluencia y Bristol, el STEP proyecto, en el que se está trabajando cómo se puede trabajar el concepto del Smart City, pero siempre desde la participación. En Donosti, por ejemplo, se está trabajando con 150 asociaciones, empresas, actores diferentes, para sacar adelante una idea de qué Smart City queremos para nuestra ciudad. Yo creo que más o menos aún me he adecuado a lo que me habéis pedido y sentir que no he podido tener una presentación, pues porque en el último momento ha habido un pequeño cambio. Gracias.
Ok. Muchas gracias. Thank you very much for Donosti's presentation here with us. Now we have enough time, I think, to just relax and think about what we have heard. And I would like to start with some thoughts and some questions to our presenters. As I said before, and it was surprising for me that we, in a Smart City Expo, we have heard words about trust, about culture, about education, about integration. And this is something which constantly comes up every now and then when we talk about successful elements for cities to be more competitive, but not only competitive, but also more socially, let's say, integrated or more socially equal. So I was wondering which is the perspective in one particular issue. We have heard about the public-private engagement, public-private participation, partnership. I was surprised in Tehran, for instance, we heard that some issues were managed by the citizenship, some others were managed by the municipality. We also get some information from Puebla. I would like to know the opinion of our presenters about how easy or how difficult it is to create partnerships in terms of management or even in terms of exchange of ideas. Why is this possible? Why are we increasingly relying in this kind of partnership? Why, as the last presenter said, we are just moving out top-down interventions, and we are more and more involving other participants, companies, citizenship, and so on. So, may I ask? Maybe you want to join us or whatever. We have another representative from Tehran, as you wish. No, it's okay. Yeah. Okay. So, who wants to? How easy? How difficult it is to produce? Okay. Good.
Well, it depends on the maturity level of the society, mm-hmm. No? But what we are doing and what we think in Puebla is you have to also get in the equation other, not only the private sector and the public sector, but also in the case of Puebla, the universities, no? As an axis of this participation or social participation for a better government, no? And we think about one thing that it's very important for these things to work, and it's trust, no? maybe we have sometimes very big governments because we don't have trust or very big companies, or we don't talk to each other, and it's a matter of trust. So working on that part always leads to better results.
In London, we're working on a platform that regroups these three stakeholders. One is, like you mentioned, university, all the academia, who has done a lot of research work over a number of years and possess data in every single thing you can imagine. Two is the industry, the public sector, that will be using this data to implement them and transform them into either services or products that are accessible to people. And number three is, of course, the city themselves, who represent the social engagement of all the people, so that this can relate the research, the implementation, and also the real bottom-up, like the mayor of Donostia was saying. What do the people want? And if even they don't express it today, social media is so strong that you can really know without asking people what is wrong about the city. And the people say it voluntarily. And so these three elements in one dialogue platform really tend to give a new form of partnership that will give new products and new services.
In Tehran, we have a short number, 137. It is the major channel the people can call us and report the problem around the city and in the city. There are other channels such as web, mobile application. We gather the data and solve the problem. And finally, we can mining the data and select the situation or roadmap for the next future to have not the same problem. I think the citizen participation is very important because we have not a lot of staff or employee, and the people can help us to find the problem on the city and solve it.
Sí, yo, muy brevemente, yo creo que soy el único cargo político que hay en esta mesa, pero yo creo que tenemos la obligación de, como administración, ofrecer los servicios públicos a la ciudadanía, pero para ello tenemos que tener en cuenta la realidad que existe en cada ciudad y los sectores que existen, económicos también, y yo creo que trabajar con estos sectores, además en una época en la que por la crisis están castigados, es obligatorio, no solamente para ayudarles a ellos a salir de la crisis y facilitarles ampliar mercados o trabajar entre empresas diferentes y buscar las complementariedades, sino que también buscando un fin, un objetivo común, que es en beneficio de toda la ciudadanía, en beneficio de toda la ciudad o todo el pueblo, implicarles en esa construcción de ciudad a todos los sectores y a toda la ciudadanía. Por lo tanto, no estamos hablando de cosas abstractas. Cuando hablamos de participación, yo creo que desde los gobiernos tenemos que tener la voluntad de que ellos aporten cómo construir ciudad y que ese aportar para construir ciudad sea siempre con un objetivo de el beneficio de toda la ciudadanía. Y yo creo que se puede hacer y, de hecho, por lo menos en ciudades pequeñitas, creo que lo estamos consiguiendo.
And this is something I really thought that it could be a quite important difference between the different cities. I mean, we were talking about a pilot city. We told him that now he can use this brand idea of Donosti as a pilot city for smart cities, no? In Barcelona, we have the 22@, which is a pilot district for many innovative products. So 80-something thousand people and 2 million people. So dimension is something which probably is playing a key role. I was also thinking about the industrial fabric. I don't know in the different case studies up to what extent the dimension of companies is important in order to be more innovative or more creative. We have tested at the University of Barcelona that small companies are producing very, very innovative products that could be sold out in a minute. I mean, Our mayor in the table said that the amount of entrepreneurs is something important in the city. I was wondering, what do you think about this idea? I mean, do we need big companies, tractor companies? Audi was somewhere in the... So do we need big companies, or maybe these small entrepreneur companies are good enough to produce an innovative or smart city? What about the role of entrepreneurs?
Maybe the answer will not be either big companies or small companies. But I would say that big clusters, no? You have to focus on certain industries and work on that, no? So this, you will have large firms, large companies, but also in the middle you will have these creative new companies. So more about talking or big or small, no? It will be more like a cluster strategy.
Any other reaction?
Sí. Bueno, quizá debemos decir que el tamaño no importa y esas cosas. Pero yo creo que sí que importa. Yo creo que las empresas grandes han sido motores económicos de muchas ciudades y de muchas regiones incluso, pero yo creo que estamos en un momento histórico en que las pequeñas y medianas empresas están consiguiendo un protagonismo que era difícil de imaginar hace muy poco tiempo. Y yo creo que en este mundo de la innovación y de los nuevos emprendedores y de trabajar entre diferentes empresas pequeñas están consiguiendo resultados que desde luego es una vía a profundizar los próximos años. Y para terminar, es verdad que Donosti por su tamaño puede ser adecuada para una serie de experimentos, pero de eso a considerar una ciudad piloto no comparto el calificativo, porque yo creo que Donosti es una de las 7 capitales del País Vasco y es verdad que todo hay que de alguna manera referenciarlo al contexto en el que vives, y yo creo que es una ciudad importante dentro del País Vasco, y sí que es verdad que su tamaño posibilita una serie de experiencias que igual sea más complicado a otros niveles. Pero lo que se hace en Donosti, estamos convencidos que es extrapolable a cualquier parte del mundo.
Thank you. I was also thinking, I will give you the floor to everybody in a minute. We have plenty of time yet. So I was thinking about transferability. And transferability of policies is something that nowadays is very much into the agenda. Learning from each other, learning what worked well in another city in order to implement it in our city. So I was thinking, which is the experience in Puebla, in Tehran, or in other cities, maybe Gaetan could start with this one, about transferability of policies. I mean, things that worked well, were innovative in one area, but now can be used in another one. Up to what extent is this important?
Well, I will catch up, connect the two ideas. One which you mentioned earlier about SMEs and I mean small entrepreneurs and all. I think it's a part of a bottom-up approach. Empower the people to be able to make the ideas, any small ideas, become a reality that transform the city and then developed into a real added product value that can be exportable and transferable. I will give you just one example or two small examples in Africa. One is in Kenya, is the mobile money, which started with the mobile phone in Kenya, and this the people transfer money with an SMS. This has become, Kenya has become the number one in the world in mobile banking, number one in the world. That started because distances were great. People could not walk to the bank. They didn't even have a bank account. And they started, and now it's number one. I give you a second example, again in Africa. In Abidjan, Côte d'Ivoire, there are no street names, no numbers, and people have to find themselves. Imagine the postman. The postman cannot find no one, but with a mobile phone, someone phones and says, I want a pizza, but how do you deliver the pizza? And you can do that. The guy will say, please don't move. I will bring it to where you are, because you can geolocalize the person. And this idea then can be exported to DHL, UPS, FedEx, or you name it. So when the city is an enabler and can make this happen, it will transform a small idea into a very high value product or service that can really be transferred and exportable to many places.
Anybody else wants to react to that? Transferability or?
Well, I think that collaboration and has been growing between cities and countries in the last years. I think, and being positive, that we are becoming more human. No, maybe it's social media, maybe it's the end of the Cold War, no? But we are becoming more human, and it has proved, no, to have better results, no? So congresses and expos like this are a physical media to exchange, to talk, to share, no? What things have been working in some cities, depending on the size, on the social distribution, etc. So I think it's possible, and I think it's growing.
We are living in Middle East, and there are some forums over there, such as Asian forums, Asian mayors forum, or OICC for the Islamic countries. And transferring the experience is very important for us. But I think the political, economical, social, technological, legal, and environmental situation is very important to make good decision for the cities.
Thank you very much. I would like now to invite people in the audience. Yeah, we have one question here. Could you please, there is one micro behind you, yes? Please introduce yourself.
Sure.
Thank you.
I'm Julian. I'm from the Austrian Trade Commission. My office is located here in Barcelona, but I'm just going to stick with English, right? I thought it was really interesting that Puebla has such a strong focus on social equality when it comes to smart city concepts. So I would like to extend the questions to the other opponents. Like, maybe you could quickly give us an overview if social equality is an issue in your cities and countries as well. I would especially be interested in the Spanish case when we think about the current crisis and people that are like actually desalojados, no, that have to leave their homes. Exactly, that people have to leave their homes. A lot of people have a very high unemployment rate. So these are issues that we don't only see in Latin America, but also here in Europe nowadays. And coming back to Mexico, maybe you could briefly explain how your implementations had an effect on poverty. Like, maybe you could give us some numbers for how long you've been treating the issue, etc. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Start with Puebla.
Well, actually, we are waiting for the next poverty municipality index. They have been doing this in the last few months. They do it every 4 years, so it was in 2010. Preliminary says that we are going to jump, no? But we have other indexes, like we have been growing almost double as a country, no? We have been on close to 5% growth in GDP in the state of Puebla. So that will reflect, no, together with these very punctual policies on these low-income sectors.
So could we say, Juan José, that in Puebla you are using technology and smartness in order to improve equality, or not only in order to be more competitive, but also in order to improve the quality of life of citizens? That was it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
Sí, se ha hecho referencia al Estado español. Yo creo que Euskal Herria, el País Vasco, dentro del Estado español, pues tiene unas tasas de economía algo más favorables que el resto del Estado. Por ejemplo, en Donosti, San Sebastián, la tasa de paro anda sobre el 12%, aunque, y el resto del Estado anda por el 20 y tantos%, aunque también es verdad que ha castigado la crisis económica y que las tasas de pobreza pues, han ido en aumento. Nosotros lo tenemos clarísimo. La igualdad social, igual que la igualdad de género, son dos temas a trabajar todos los días en cualquier política que hagas, en cualquier terreno de la política. Y desde luego, lo que no puede ser es que admitamos un sistema que, por ejemplo, en Donosti, las 4.500 personas que recogen ayudas de emergencia social, dos tercios de estas personas son gente que están o trabajando o cobran una pensión. Pero ambas dos son indignas, porque son trabajos que no les remuneran lo suficiente para poder vivir dignamente hasta final de mes, o son gente que ha trabajado toda la vida y su jubilación no le llega para encender la calefacción en invierno. Y yo lo tengo clarísimo, y puede no ser compartido por todos, pero no podemos construir ciudad, no podemos pensar en smart cities mientras tengamos un solo ciudadano, una sola ciudadana, que no puede llegar a fin de mes. Entonces, eso tiene que ser la prioridad absoluta. Antes hablaba de participación y prioridad. Y he dicho que en una época de crisis económica, lo primero es activar la economía para generar trabajo, trabajo digno, pero también hacer las ayudas sociales necesarias para que nadie pueda estar en una situación precaria, como existen muchos y muchos en el Estado español y en el resto del mundo, por supuesto. Es la gran prioridad.
Hello.
Yeah.
A question here.
Yeah, we have a question. Hello. Introduce yourself.
My name is Mohammad Hanish. I'm a delegate from India and undersecretary with the government of India. Just a question here. Across the developing worlds as well as India, and most often across many hemispheres, all the hemispheres here, there is a problem with regard to slum development. The development of the slums and also the recreation of living equitable spaces wherein slums existed in the past is a major question to be addressed by the cities. And for such socially equitable schemes to take place, huge investments from the government is required, and we cannot rely on the private sector or private participation. And that entails hefty expenditure from the government side. How do we really balance it with the kind of private participation and the kind of, you know, private finances that's brought in to create new smart cities? There is a critical element of social equity attached to it. How would you address that critical question?
There has been a very interesting experience in Brazil, in Curitiba, about this kind of situation. In the favelas, the then mayor of Curitiba, Jaime Lerner, he sort of transformed politically the favela into free zones. That is, any private sector company who would like to invest and settle there, their company, they will not pay taxes on the profits they make. Secondly, if they do employ people from that favela, they will earn extra benefits for them to in terms of credits in taxes and other expenses that they would have used. So it was an interesting way for them to get the private sector to be there, start new businesses, and employ the people who live there to develop new products and new services in the city. And of course, government and the municipality has to do their social job in terms of slums upgrading and all, and bringing the minimum infrastructures to these places. But getting the private sector was a very interesting idea, which I found has been developed there.
Sí, es que es una respuesta muy política. Yo creo que hablamos de modelos también políticos. Yo creo que estamos hablando de distribuir la riqueza, pero no solamente a nivel de ciudad, sino a nivel de todo el mundo, cómo se hace eso, si fiscalmente se pueden hacer políticas en las que se pueda distribuir de una manera acertada, o como se estaba mencionando ahora, y yo creo que desde los municipios se puede hacer, se puede incentivar, como hacemos nosotros, a que esas nuevas empresas, esos emprendedores que empiezan con nuevas empresas, en este caso relacionadas con la Smart City, con la innovación, con mil temas, están contratando gente que está en paro, de alguna manera conseguir que aquellos que están incentivando el empleo pues tengan una serie de ayudas desde la administración pública. Pero hay una pregunta fundamental con lo que ha dicho este señor, que es cuando hablamos de participación y de que las Smart City nos impliquemos en la ciudadanía y las empresas en general, es muy difícil implicar a una ciudadanía que no tiene nada que comer. El que no tiene nada que comer bastante tiene con buscar comida para el día siguiente. Entonces, los primeros problemas que hay que solucionar son los básicos. Y una vez teniendo los básicos, podemos ir a pensar en otras cosas. Entonces, insisto en el que es muy difícil hablar de construir ciudad en unos parámetros de participación y de implicación de la ciudadanía si los problemas básicos de asistencia no están asegurados. Y en eso la administración pública tiene muchísimo que decir, claro.
May I add something, which is how can we use technology and what we have been sharing, that digital tsunami, it's allowing us to be more participative, to be more informative, to be more aware of what's going on. My question would be, how can we use that in order to use these technologies for improving the, for instance, slum renewal? But of course, you are talking from India, but talking from Spain and from Barcelona, for instance, how can we empower and how can we improve the quality of life of citizens living in the peripheral areas, for instance, in any city, or how, I mean, it's not my turn to talk. Is there any other question? We would really appreciate somebody else commenting, questioning, just giving a thought. Yes, please.
Hello, my name is Ignacio Razuriz. I am representing the Chilean Trade Association of Construction. And I would like to have maybe more insights on what the mayor of Dinostia said about that we cannot be concerned or working on smart cities or technology before we have already solutioned more elemental needs, like someone maybe having a home or paying the rent. So my concern is that when we see the stands and we discuss here at the seminar, we're usually speaking about a technological approach to what city, to what smart cities means. And sometimes, as we have heard, cities have other priorities which need to be addressed before. So I would like to know what is the correct balance in your point of view between the efforts and the resources that need to be put in technology versus the more elemental needs. Should they be addressed at the same time, simultaneously, or should we need to address first more elemental needs? Because we can think of technology maybe in more developed countries to solve the people's needs at the moment, but in developing countries, we most of the time have more elemental needs. So I would like to have more insight on that topic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sí, a ver, me piden rapidez. Cuando es una pregunta complicada, de verdad. Pero es verdad que, antes lo he dicho al principio de mi intervención, hay palabras claves a la hora de tomar decisiones en cualquier administración y yo he mencionado dos. Una es participación y otra es priorización. Y es verdad que cuando hay unas necesidades básicas es lo prioritario, pero también es verdad que las apuestas que haces en invertir en innovación o invertir en cultura o nuevas tecnologías son apuestas que también haces con el objetivo de mejorar las desigualdades sociales que puedan existir. Y yo creo que antes he puesto el ejemplo de que invertir en cultura en una época de crisis parece que es ir contracorriente. Sin embargo, apostar por la cultura en una época de crisis estás consiguiendo, por una parte, generar una economía, pero por otra, tener una herramienta que da una cohesión social y hacer que gente muy diferente trabajen en proyectos comunes. Y con la innovación no está pasando igual. Nosotros en Donosti, que ya tiene un caldo de cultivo en torno a las nuevas tecnologías e innovación importante, porque existen parques tecnológicos, universidades y empresas en estos campos, hay gente emprendedora que ha ido a ese sector para salir adelante. Y de alguna manera nuestra apuesta desde la administración es ayudemos a una innovación y que esa innovación además ayude a dar solución a esos problemas de desigualdad que existen. Se puede hacer a la vez, pero teniendo siempre claro que la prioridad es vamos a acabar con las desigualdades sociales para buscar una sociedad en la que todos participen y que esa participación la sientan como algo fructífero para aportar en la creación de una nueva ciudad.
Muchas gracias por la brevedad. Do we have time for a very small question, very immediate question? No, no more questions, no more thoughts. Yeah, please. React. I'm sorry.
It's a simple question which needs to be addressed by all of us. We need finances for every sort of urban development. Unless and until it comes from a synergy with the private sector, it has to come from us, and that leads to greater taxations. Would our people belonging to different strata of society have the kind of capacity to pay such taxes, or would it ultimately lead us to slide down anarchy? That's a question which we need to answer whenever we discuss upon this issue of creating smart cities. I would just have a quick take on it.
Thank you. Well, I think that could be used as the end sentence, maybe. But let me just summarize in five brief points, things that I consider were relevant in our discussion. First, I think that we have to take into account what do we mean by short run and long run, short term and long term. I mean, sometimes priorities, because that's related to what we can solve in the short run. Sometimes being a smart city or being innovative is a long-term objective, but that doesn't mean that we do not deal with daily problems or programs in our cities. Priorities were mentioned, and I think that this is really something from the local point of view, from the institutional point of view, something that is relevant. We learned today that culture and technology can be together, should be together, because at the end of the day, technology is everywhere as culture should be everywhere. The idea of an integrated approach to coping with the problems of cities today, I think that this is important to keep that in mind. I mean, the digital tsunami, again, no? We have to use technology to cope with many, many important different problems in our cities. And finally, and this is the closing sentence, I think that empowerment of citizenship is also something to take into account. We are moving from a very public-oriented decision-making to a much more shared decision process. So, well, I would like to thank you, all our presenters. Thank you very much for being so nice in order to fulfill the rules and the timing. And thank you to the audience for being here. Thank you very much.